little more me, please. Many, many, many nights, her light was too bright, so she turned away and she stood alone every day and every night. Then she turned to me. I like the mood lighting. To me.
My pleasure to introduce this evening's featured speaker for Black History Month. And I just want to share with you a little bit of our speaker's background. Reverend Dr. Nekima Levy-Pounds is a civil rights attorney, freedom fighter, a legal scholar, blogger, and nationally recognized expert on issues at the intersections of race, public policy, economic justice, public education, juvenile justice, and the criminal justice system. Many of you first came to know Dr. Levy-Pounds from the prominent role that she played in the nationally covered Mall of America Black Lives Matter protests, December 20th, 2014. That event, which attracted an estimated 3,000 protesters, shut down the Mall of America for several hours and resulted in multiple arrests and legal charges against Dr. Levy-Pounds and several other protesters, charges that were later dropped. Dr. Levy-Pounds also played a prominent role in several protests prior to and following that successful Mall of America protest, including several actions that shut down commuter traffic on I-35 and I-94, the 18-day vigil that we all recall from at the 4th Precinct following the killing of Jamar Clark in 2015, and the shutdown of Terminal 1 at the MSP airport in December of 2015. Dr. Levy-Pounds is also a former Minneapolis NAACP president. But Dr. Levy-Pounds' history of advocacy and activism goes back much further than this tenure that I've shared. Arguably, the most recognizable face in the contemporary Twin Cities civil rights movement, Dr. Levy-Pounds grew up in South Central Los Angeles in the 1980s, where she witnessed the intersection of race and poverty, where gangs, scarce resources, and inequality dominated her neighborhood. And having seen television lawyers portrayed as people who could affect change and help others, at the age of 9, a very precocious young Levy-Pounds decided that that was what she was meant to do. PLP, as her St. Thomas students affectionately called her, came to Minneapolis in 2003 to start the Family Law Clinic, in which was then the university's brand new law school. She went on to found the Community Justice Project, which connected UST law students with the opportunity to impact real social issues while completing their law studies. Today, Dr. Levy-Pounds joins us to talk about what's next on the civil rights frontier for her, for the Twin Cities metro area, and as the nation responds to a new administration, what the future holds for our country. Please give a warm University of Minnesota welcome to our Black History Month keynote speaker, Dr. Nekima Levy-Pounds.
Thank you, Will.
Good to see you.
Thank you. Thanks for that introduction. How are you guys doing tonight? I said, how are y'all doing tonight? All right, just because many of you guys are in grad school, doesn't mean that you get to lose your energy and your sense of humor, because I've been there, done that, bought the t-shirt, and you have to remain open, flexible, creative, and energetic, because we're talking about a fight for racial, social, and economic justice that didn't just start in 2014 when Mike Brown was killed by Officer Darren Wilson in Ferguson, Missouri. We're talking about hundreds of years of oppression. We're talking about racial discrimination. We're talking about policies and practices and systems and institutions that have been put in place to keep the poorest of the poor down, and particularly poor people of color. So we have a lot of work on our hands, and we have to prepare for this fight, and we have to be resilient. We have to have fortitude. We have to understand what has happened historically. We have to understand what is happening contemporarily. And then we have to understand what is each of our roles in this fight for justice. So I got to this point where I'm on the front lines fighting for freedom, justice, and equality as a result of my background, which Bill Woodson talked about. It didn't actually start in South Central Los Angeles, although that is where I grew up in the 1980s. It actually started in Jackson, Mississippi. So I was born in Jackson, Mississippi, about 8 years after the assassination of Dr. King. I believe that that time frame is relevant because a lot of us know some of the things that happened during the Civil Rights Movement, which essentially started on December 1st of 1955, when Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat to a white man on a bus in Montgomery, Alabama, which most of us are familiar with, and it spanned essentially through April 4th of 1968, when Dr. King was killed. So we know that during that period of time of the Civil Rights Movement, we saw a lot of moving and shaking happening in our nation. And I think that one's perspective about what happened during that movement depends upon who you actually are, your background and experiences. So for example, maybe about 4 or 5 years ago, I remember being on NPR, and we were talking about JFK's legacy. And there was a professor from the U of M who was also part of that conversation. And so the radio host asked, you know, what was the 1960s like for the United States? And this was a white male professor. And his response was, well, you know, this was a great period in our history. You know, there was a lot of peace and, you know, people were searching for this. And I'm thinking, wait, are we talking about the same period of history? And so when the radio host turned to me, I said it was a very tumultuous time in American history because it was at the height of the Civil Rights Movement. And as a matter of fact, Dr. King and many other leaders during that movement had to shake and awaken JFK out of his slumber so that he could recognize the continuous struggles within the African-American community. They had to get JFK to use his bully pulpit to even challenge business owners who supported segregation and who were upholding Jim Crow laws within their companies. And so I remember reading about JFK calling those business owners together and asking them, why won't you allow black people to shop in your stores? And many of them said to JFK, well, we want to, but we're concerned that our white customers will no longer patronize our businesses. And I believe that their response is symbolic of the response that we see time and time again throughout our history when a group of people are facing oppression. You have one response from the powers that be, which more often than not tends to be maintaining the status quo. You have another response from people who have certain levels of control, wealth, who run companies, excuse me, and a lot of those people tend to also maintain the status quo. Because if they engage in acts that require heroism and courage, they're often worried about their bottom line, the impacts on their businesses, et cetera. And then you have a response from the masses, the mainstream, which again, only a handful of people, a minority of people, a remnant, actually rise up, speak up, put their lives and bodies on the lines to resist oppression, while most of the people are complacent. Most of the people are comfortable with the status quo. Most of the people participate in systems of oppression. And participation doesn't necessarily mean that you are sitting behind a desk writing the laws. It doesn't mean that you're responsible for enacting the laws. But it may mean that you're responsible when laws and policies are put forward that you know in your spirit, your heart, and mind are unjust, and you do absolutely nothing about it. So silence is one of the greatest weapons. When you think about it, for those who are comfortable with what's happening with the status quo. And on top of the three groups that I mentioned, so I talked about government, talked about those who have some form of power, such as control over companies. I talked about the masses and their reaction when oppression is going on. But I want to talk about that remnant that I referenced earlier. That's that group of people who get to the point where they are so fed up with injustice that they are willing to do whatever it takes to fight back. And I would argue that those were the people who rose up during what we know as the civil rights movement, because those people risked police brutality. They risked oppression and abuse and sometimes murder at the hands of white terrorist organizations. They risked discomfort within their own communities from some who were afraid of how the backlash was going to impact everyone. And they wanted the people in the community to just sit down, just wait for change to happen, and to be quiet so that you don't affect the rest of us. They faced all those things, and yet they rose up anyway. And because of the fact that they rose up, specifically Rosa Parks, as I referenced on December 1st of 1955, they brought the system of Jim Crow in the South to its knees. And we have to recognize that when we're talking about this Jim Crow system, we are talking about a very sophisticated system of oppression. We're talking about the fact that the majority of people who lived in the South during that period of time participated in that system. I gave a talk earlier today at a local company, and I talked about the fact that when Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat, that she was taking a stand against racial injustice and oppression. And I talked about why she did it. So later in life, Rosa Parks talked about the fact that on that day when she refused to give up her seat, all she could think about was Emmett Till. So for those who may not be familiar with Emmett Till, Emmett Till was a 14-year-old black boy who grew up in Chicago, Illinois, but his mother was from Money, Mississippi. His mother's name was Mamie Till. And his mother was, of course, familiar with the ways of the Deep South, the written rules and the unwritten rules. But even knowing that, you know, Emmett really wanted to visit relatives in Mississippi, and so Mamie Till allowed him to go. She didn't know that sending him on that trip would be the last time that she would see her son alive. Now, if you go online, you look at pictures of Emmett Till, you will see that he was such a handsome young man, just beautiful. And one of the things about Emmett Till was the fact that as he was growing up in Chicago, he was more used to integration, living in a big city and having white children in his classroom, interacting with white folks, and not having some of the same remnants of slavery that were present in the Deep South. Now, believe me, there were and are still remnants of slavery in Chicago, Illinois, just like all around this nation, but it was still a different culture. And so on one occasion while Emmett was in Money, Mississippi, he walked into a local store that was owned by a white couple. And the story has it that he either whistled at this white woman, her last name was Bryant, or he said, "Bye, baby," when he was walking out of the store. Well, after he did that, the young people who were with him said, "You shouldn't have done that," and told him that he would be in some type of trouble. So he asked them to not tell anyone what he had done. A few days later, in the middle of the night, the husband of the woman in the store came banging on Emmett Till's uncle's door and asked where he was. And they didn't want to give him up, but they had to, because they felt that their lives, all of their lives, would be in danger. And they said, "We just want to talk to the boy." And so it was the husband and it was his half-brother. Well, they took Emmett Till into an abandoned building, And they beat him, and they beat him, and they beat him, and they tortured him, and they tortured him, and they tortured him. They wound up shooting him. They wound up mutilating him. They placed a tire around his neck, and they threw his body in the Tallahatchie River. And when his body was pulled up out of the river, he was unrecognizable. He didn't look like that beautiful 14-year-old boy that his mother, Mamie, had sent to Money, Mississippi. He looked like a monster. And at the time of his death, it sent shockwaves throughout the nation, especially for those who may have felt that society had become post-racial. Somehow this illusion creeps up, you know, every decade or so that it's a post-racial society. Well, back then it was very similar. And so rather than request a closed casket funeral, Mamie Till actually demanded an open casket funeral. She wanted the world to see her son's face, his disfigured face, because she said it represented the ugliness of racial hatred in America. For those who haven't seen his pictures, you can look those after pictures. You see the before pictures, you can see those after pictures online, but I want to give a trigger warning, because if you see his face, it is hard to believe that someone would do that to a child. See, black children were not off limits in terms of facing oppression and abuse and terrorism and discrimination and sometimes being killed. I don't understand why we would think that black children would be off limits. Because again, if you go all the way back to the days of slavery, we saw that black children were really treated no differently than black adults in terms of the abuse that they encountered. So in that moment when Emmett Till was killed by those two white men, it brought back memories of abuse, oppression, and it reminded people that they still were not safe in America, even though slavery has purportedly ended. And so on that fateful day of December 1st of 1955, when Rosa Parks got on that bus, she wasn't sitting in the white section of the bus, contrary to some of the stories that have been told. She was sitting in the first row of seats that were reserved for coloreds only. And I can imagine on that day when she refused to give up her seat, thinking about the murder of Emmett Till, which later she said she was thinking about him. I can imagine her thinking about the fact that the justice system did not work in Emmett Till's case, because the two men who killed him were, no surprise to many of us, tried by an all-white jury. And that all-white jury found them not guilty. And later, after the trial ended and the verdict was rendered, those two men did an interview with Look magazine, and they told the full story, and they were paid for their confession about killing Emmett Till. So I can imagine Rosa Parks feeling that it was unjust and unfair and inhumane for a 14-year-old boy to be killed, for him to be the symbol of continued racial hatred in America, for his killers to be tried by an all-white jury, for the system to not work, and for him to be found guilty, and for her to decide for them to be found not guilty, and for her to get to the point where she made a decision that I'm just not going to take it anymore. I'm not going to continue to participate in a system of evil and oppression. So on that day, she said, I don't care what they do to me. I'm not giving up my seat to a white man. And I thank God that as a woman, a black woman, she had a source of courage that could not have been of this world, because she had no idea what impact she would face as a result of what she had done. Now, a lot of us look at wonderful pictures of Rosa Parks looking like this sweet older woman with glasses, but the other pictures that we don't see are the pictures of her mugshot. The fact that she was arrested on that day in question. She was also the secretary of the NAACP at the time. She had been investigating sex abuse cases against black women. And all of the feelings, the memories, All of those things came to a head when she refused to give up her seat. Now, one of the beautiful things about her act of heroism was that it lit a spark throughout the African-American community. So people who had been complacent, and I call complacency walking to a blacks-only, colors-only water fountain and drinking every single day and encouraging your children to drink every single day when they're asking, Mom, why do I have to drink out of this water fountain? That water fountain looks better. The water looks cooler. Why do I have to use this broken-down water fountain? The parents saying, well, that's just the way that it is. Or being complacent in a system where you can only use bathrooms that say colored only. And every time you have to use the bathroom, if there is one available, having to be reminded of the fact that people see you as being inferior and using those restrooms, which often were not as clean, which were not built up often the same way as the whites-only bathrooms. Or having to rush through on a road trip through certain parts of the city, certain parts of states, certain parts of the community, so that you wouldn't get caught in a sundown town, which could mean the difference between life and death. Having to travel and not having a place where you could stay at night because of hotels being reserved for whites only. Or sending your children to substandard schools because they were considered to be colored and therefore intellectually inferior and not quite human. So you can imagine the scores of African Americans who had become conditioned to accept that way of life and who were fearful of challenging the status quo and who discouraged their children from challenging the status quo and how much courage it took for them to line up with Rosa Parks' vision of a new way of living their lives. Because that's essentially what she did. She set a new order when she said, no, we need to get to the point where we resist and refuse oppression instead of continually going along with it. And I'm thankful that the Black community, particularly Black churches, rose up in support of Rosa Parks, and they declared, we are going to boycott the bus system. We're going to hit them in the pockets. They don't want to treat us like human beings. We're not going to ride their buses at all. So for well over a year, they refused to ride the buses in Montgomery, Alabama. They walked, even elders, walking to and fro wherever they needed to go. They carpooled, they took taxi cabs, they did whatever they had to do to avoid riding on those buses that were a symbol of oppression for the community. And after more than 1 year of refusing to ride those buses, finally, the bus system gave in, and they declared that the buses would be integrated. And that was the beginning of the unraveling of the Jim Crow system as we know it. Their act of heroism sparked young people to join the front lines in the fight for racial, social, and economic justice. Those young people often walked out of colleges, just like this one, and went and sat at lunch counters, not just in the Deep South, but even in the Twin Cities of Minnesota. Because we love talking about how progressive of a state that we live in, but we don't realize that this is actually the Jim Crow North. That's what I call it today, not 20, 40, 60 years, today. The Jim Crow North. And when you look at the racial disparities, it underscores that point. Because when we talk about the fact that Minnesota is one of the most literate states in the country, we need to add the caveat for white people. When we talk about the fact that it's one of the places with the highest rates of home ownership, we have to add the caveat for white people. When we talk about the fact that people have some of the highest income levels in the country right here in Minnesota, we have to add the caveat for white people. And then for African Americans and American Indians, the opposite is actually true. And we have to get to the point where we begin to ask the question of why. This is not happening randomly. Economic injustice is not happening through osmosis. The system of mass incarceration and its impact on people of color in Minnesota is not just happening because someone woke up one day and said, hey, let's fill our jails. It's a part of a process and patterns that have been put in place from a very long time ago, where if they remain unchanged, they continue to perpetuate, which is symbolic of what has happened in the United States of America. And somehow, because we have some federal legislation that's passed, or we have someone espousing rhetoric saying so much has changed, we forget that not enough has changed, and it hasn't happened quick enough, and there's so much more work for us to do. But see, after Rosa refused to give up her seat, young people not only went and sat at the lunch counters, they left the North, jumped on buses, went to the Deep South and places like where I'm from in Mississippi, got off those buses and started registering Black people to vote. Even though they should have been able to vote during that period of time, we know that there was so much terrorism preventing them from being able to vote. We know that poll taxes were put in place that charged poor people money that they could not afford to vote. Literacy tests put in place that the people administering the tests could not pass themselves, put in place to prevent people from voting, because they knew the power of the vote, especially in the aftermath of slavery, during the Reconstruction era, when we saw so many Black people elected to Congress in this country, who were able to actually change things and to begin to build up their communities. So they understood the power of the vote. And that was part of their reason for attempting to deny it. So part of understanding that history of the civil rights movement is understanding how it's a part of the overarching struggle, the one that happened before the civil rights movement and the one that is happening today. So let us go back even further. Let's think about what happened during the institution of slavery. Now we know that it was one of the most brutal, inhumane systems known to man. With the research that I've done about what happened during slavery, it honestly sometimes makes me sick to my stomach, because it's hard to see how one set of human beings could treat another set of human beings like they were not human, like they were property, oftentimes treating them worse than animals. Thinking about the fact that Black men had no real rights during that time, neither did Black women, neither did Black children. Even for those Black men who were trying to create a family, live with their wives, live with their children, at any point in time could be forced to let their families go. Their families being forced into slavery and perhaps them never seeing their family members again. Or slave owners calling for their wives at night, and there was nothing that they could do. Calling for their baby girls at night, there was nothing that they could do. There are even stories about Black men being raped by overseers during slavery. Stories that we hardly ever hear. Stories about Black pregnant women. When it was time for them to be disciplined, they would carve out a hole in the dirt, make the woman lie down, put her belly in the dirt, and whip her back and, you know, the back of her body parts. Can you imagine? That's what they endured. Stories about people being tied to horses and ripped, two horses in opposing directions, and forcing those horses to run in opposite directions and ripping someone's body to pieces. Brutally beating people, maiming them, cutting off their limbs. Beyond the physical and the emotional abuse that came out of that system of slavery, there was also this notion about keeping this group of people in ignorance by denying them the right to an education, something that we sometimes take for granted because we didn't have to go through as much. Yes, it might be hard when you have student loans, which I know something about. It might be hard to get into an institution, but the reality is that it's possible for us. But back during the days of slavery, it was a crime to teach slaves to read. So not only could the slave who wanted to learn how to read be maimed or even killed, but that person, that slave owner, or a relative of the slave owner trying to teach someone to read, the same thing could happen to them. Why deny someone access to an education unless you know that education removes ignorance and opens the door to opportunity? But that's what happened from one generation after the next. The beautiful part about that, though, is that there were some people during slavery who fought to learn how to read, such as Frederick Douglass. He became one of the greatest orators on behalf of the African-American community, and I would argue one of the greatest orators in the nation. He tricked his slave owners into teaching him how to read. Learned to read, learned to write, what became free during that period of time, so he escaped slavery and got together with abolitionists who helped him put together a newspaper where he wrote prolifically, even authored his autobiography talking about his experience in slavery and the inhumane conditions that he experienced, and wound up counseling Abraham Lincoln. Even though that his role wasn't shown in the movie Lincoln, he was a huge influencer on Abraham Lincoln's decision to put forward the Emancipation Proclamation and to take the country into civil war. And of course, some argue it was about maintaining the Union. It was about whether slavery would continue to happen in these United States or not. And Frederick Douglass, again, a black man born into slavery, played a role in all of that, had to take risks with his life and his livelihood in order to do his part. Now, one of the interesting things about what happened after the Emancipation Proclamation was put forward was the enactment of the 13th Amendment to the Constitution. So I went to law school, studied constitutional law, it was a required class. We studied the 13th Amendment, and we just glossed over it. We just said, oh yeah, it abolished slavery, and then we moved on. Well, in 2006, I was preparing to participate in a conference in Gloucester, England. And it was focused on the impacts of slavery worldwide, because there was, you know, the slave trade that happened in England, and they wound up abolishing it later, calling it an odious institution. And so as I was preparing my presentation, which was focused on the US criminal justice system as a form of modern day slavery in America, I started trying to figure out, well, where did this start? You know, how did we get to the point where we have so many African Americans enslaved inside of this system of mass incarceration? So as I started doing my research, it took me back to the 13th Amendment of the Constitution. But in 2006, I read it differently than I had read it just a few years earlier when I was in law school. Now, I'm gonna paraphrase it, but 13th Amendment says that neither slavery nor involuntary servitude shall be allowed, except if one has been duly convicted of a crime. Now, given the history that I just ran off, just a small bit of the history about what happened during the institution of slavery, if our nation was serious about abolishing it, the 13th Amendment would simply read, neither slavery nor involuntary servitude shall ever, 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 ever be allowed again in the United States. But that's not what happened. They essentially opened the door to a new form of slavery through the criminal justice system. And many Southern states changed their laws on the books to make standard behavior by black men a crime. And this is well documented in a book called Slavery by Another Name, which was written by historian Douglas Blackman. And he went through the history of the ways in which black men were criminalized for routine behavior. So for example, a black men hanging out late at night, that was a crime. Black men spitting on a sidewalk, that was a crime. Being unemployed was a crime. Talking too loud was a crime. Now, we may think that that's far-fetched, that someone would be able to criminalize standard behavior, but let's think about loitering, which is a law that's on many of the books in many jurisdictions today. Let's think about disorderly conduct. That statute is so vague, and the ordinance in Minneapolis is so vague. If one of you jumped up right now and ran up and down the aisle making noise, you would essentially be guilty of disorderly conduct, having your behavior criminalized. Now, spitting on a sidewalk, up until a couple of years ago, because of the fact that we fought against that law, so I had my law students at St. Thomas research all of the low-level ordinances in the city of Minneapolis, because we were concerned about the connection between low-level crimes and unnecessary contact with law enforcement. And I said, there has to be something with these low-level laws drawing people into the criminal justice system unnecessarily. So I said, let's look up all the low-level ordinances, look at their origin, figure out, you know, why they're on the books, what impacts they're having. And so my law students did that. And we saw several laws on the books that shouldn't have been there. Spitting and lurking were two of the low-hanging fruit that we saw. So a law against spitting on the sidewalk. And that law was not being used in Minneapolis to stop white joggers who were spitting. It was being used to stop young African-American men. So it was being used as a pretext to stop, frisk, harass them, and sometimes arrest them, particularly in North Minneapolis. And as a matter of fact, when we did the research, what we saw was that the law against spitting was put on the books in the 1800s as a result of a tuberculosis scare in the city of Minneapolis. So at the time, they thought that tuberculosis could be transmitted through spitting. Now, medical evidence shows that that's simply not possible, but guess what? No one went back and changed the law. So it was on the books all this time being used as a pretext, stopping fresh young black men. And then there was a law against lurking as well. Now, no one could actually give you an intelligent definition of lurking. And in many jurisdictions, we found that lurking was actually unconstitutional. And people were being charged and arrested for lurking with intent to commit a crime. Well, how would you know that someone has an intention of committing a crime unless you're inside of their minds? You know, like one of those movies, Minority Report, you know, where you're able actually to see what someone's planning to do. How would you know that they're lurking with intent to commit a crime? But that's exactly what was happening. Now, think about if you're a person being charged with these crimes, because they're such low-level offenses, you're often not granted legal representation. So no public defender, no one showing up. You're afraid, maybe having never been in the system before, and prosecutors are coming to you with plea deals on the table. You're thinking about, am I going to miss work? Am I going to miss time away from my family? What's going to happen to me? What if I go to trial and I'm found guilty, which you probably would be, because the law was warped to begin with. And so you have people facing compounded effects by going into court, pleading guilty, not knowing that that guilty plea was going to impact them for years to come because of something known as collateral consequences. Now, collateral consequences are extrajudicial punishments. So when you go through the judicial process, maybe, you know, someone's sentenced to a couple years in jail or prison. Maybe they have probation. Those are punishments within the system. But collateral consequences may mean when you go to apply for a job, oh, you were arrested 5 times for spitting, we can't hire you. Or, oh, you have a disorderly conduct charge or a lurking charge, that sounds kind of scary. We are not going to rent to you. And that's what was happening to people. And believe it or not, when we did our analysis of what was happening, we said, you know, let's choose two of the laws that should be easiest to get off the books, because these are reminiscent of the black codes. So the black codes are the laws that I mentioned earlier that essentially criminalize black male behavior. So we said these are Minneapolis black codes, and we need to get them off the books. And we took it to City Hall, and we talked to 2 city council members and someone from the mayor's office, and we said these laws need to be off the books. And the response that we got was one that I didn't initially expect, which was sort of reticence about advocating for those laws to be taken off the table. And for some of the people, they made excuses about why. And we had to convince them that it was politically viable to fight for those laws to be taken off the table. And I remember in one of the meetings having to take off my law professor hat and put on my hat as an activist and to say, wait a minute, we're saying we're progressive, we're saying we're liberal, then prove it. This is the least that we can do to show that we're serious about racial equity in the city of Minneapolis. Now, what do we need to do to get this done? And at the end of that process, we agreed that we were going to try. We said we will gather people from other organizations who will advocate for this issue. We'll bring in young people to testify. We'll be relentless in our advocacy. We'll educate people. And that's what we had to do. And so over a period of a couple months, we saw the battle play out in terms of some of our corporations that did not want the ordinances off the books. There was one prominent business leader who even was quoted in the paper saying, if you take this law off the books, people will be lurking in trees. Now, it was quite offensive, but we took his words and we put it on social media, and there were all kinds of pictures of people sitting in trees, standing by trees, saying, here I am lurking, putting their children in trees. We just took social media and flipped the script just to show the ignorance of that statement. But through that process of coming to the table and advocating and having young Black people testify about the dehumanizing treatment that they were experiencing at the hands of law enforcement, we got those two ordinances repealed by a vote of 12-1. And that was at a time, again, when people did not think that it was possible. But in my spirit, I said, we're not gonna let this go. This is just the bare minimum. There are still so many laws on our books, and that was just at the city level. So imagine at the state level, the laws that are on the books that are unnecessary, a waste of law enforcement resources. I mean, we have serious crimes that sometimes happen in the city of Minneapolis. So we're diverting resources from problem solving and major crime fighting to go, oop, he spat, let's go get him. You know, it just makes absolutely no sense. And then we keep finding justifications for expanding the public safety budget. But what we won't do is increase access to economic opportunity by creating more jobs, by opening the doors of City Hall so that residents who live in the city have a fighting chance to actually work in the city and earning a living wage. Those are the same battles that they were fighting back in the day when they experienced economic injustice, being denied access to employment opportunities so that they could feed their families, so that they could try to release themselves from the vestiges of slavery, and facing economic injustice instead. That was one of the last fights that Dr. King actually took on. He was in Memphis when he was killed, working and standing on behalf of striking sanitation workers, primarily Black men who were not being protected through their unions, who were having to work in unsanitary, of course, conditions. They were sanitation workers, but the conditions that they faced were worse than their white counterparts, and placed in dangerous situations as well. At least one sanitation worker had been killed, and finally it was enough for the men during that time to say, we can't continue to tolerate this. We just want to come to work every day. We just want to be able to make enough to feed our families and to have a roof over our heads. Why do we have to face discrimination on our jobs because of the color of our skin? And thankfully, Dr. King and other people who were part of the movement agreed with them, and they took the fight to Memphis, and that's where Dr. King was assassinated. Now, interestingly, before Dr. King was assassinated, he actually declared something that I think helped to seal his fate. In November of 1967, Dr. King said, "We are going to launch a poor people's campaign in Washington, D.C." He said, we're going to go there in April of 1968, and we're going to demand several things, and we're not going to leave Washington, D.C. until we get what we came for. He said that we're going to advocate for a guaranteed minimum income for all Americans. We're going to push for a higher minimum wage. We're going to push for affordable housing, and we're going to demand universal health care. Now, think about that. The fight was initially about the recognition of the humanity of African Americans, just saying, listen, we want to be able to drink out of whatever water fountain, use whatever bathroom, sleep at whatever hotel, eat at whatever lunch counter, send our children to whatever school we want without having to feel like we are inferior, like we're less than, like we're subhuman. Now, that was a huge enough fight, taking on the obvious signs of racial hatred, the obvious signs. But then when you start going after the system of capitalism, that's a whole other ballgame. That threatens to turn our entire economic system on its head, especially if they had granted the things that Dr. King had asked for. And so it should not be a surprise to most of us that that's when Dr. King became the most dangerous. It's no coincidence that he said that they were going to Washington, D.C. in April of 1968 and that he was assassinated on the fourth day of April in 1968. See, that's the part that we don't talk about when we celebrate his birthday. We're all like, kumbaya, I have a dream, his dream is alive, let's come together. And it's like, wait a minute. Well, how did he die again? Wait, what happened? Why did it happen? Did the things that he asked for actually come to full fruition? Or are we still facing a lot of these challenges? And I think through some of these celebrations, he'd be turning over in his grave, like, what are you guys doing? You guys are immortalizing me, celebrating my life, having a feel-good kumbaya moment, and what are you doing the other 364 days a year to fight for the things that I fought for, to help my dream actually come to fruition? And I would argue that most of us would fall far short. And part of that has to do with the fact that we're lulled to sleep by a lot of the things that are going on in this world. Even our young people being so preoccupied, because you want to go to school, you want to get your education, you want to have a good life, and they're making it more and more difficult because the cost of higher education continues to skyrocket. And when people are worried about putting food on the table, they're going to be less likely to rise up and express dissent and express discontent with what's going on, because it's going to impact your livelihood. It could impact your family, your career, the whole nine yards. And I know this struggle from personal experience, because back when I just left the University of St. Thomas Law School in June of 2016, and this was after being on the law faculty for 13 years. Now, yes, I had tenure, thank God. And yes, I was a full professor of law. But at the time that I got involved in activism, I had no real guarantees that it wasn't going to have a significant impact on my life, my livelihood, and my family. So I had to take a calculated risk about having a feeling of safety and what I would argue was a false sense of security versus going down a similar path as my ancestors who fought back and resisted oppression. I chose the path that they went on. And I would say to a large degree, it wasn't actually voluntary. So when I was at St. Thomas, I used to write about mass incarceration, the impacts of the war on drugs on poor communities of color, and, you know, looking at issues such as civil rights, slavery, et cetera. And at the time, I thought I was an activist. You know, I would have in my little bio line, she's a scholar activist, she's whoop whoop, you know. But then, did I say whoop whoop? Okay, my bad. But, so I thought I was an activist. But the honest truth is when things happened and started unfolding in Ferguson, I remember safely sitting behind my computer screen, watching what was going on, and thinking to myself, wow, that is not my fight. I'm not going to Ferguson. That looks chaotic. And being able to comfortably write articles like, the war on drugs and mass incarceration played a role in the unfolding events in Ferguson. You know, and I was like proud of myself, like, yeah, you know, I'm connecting the dots between what happened then, what's happening now, but I did not think that it was my fight. I didn't realize how privileged I had become accustomed to being while I was at St. Thomas. And so one of the things that changed my life was in November of 2014, It was the day in which the grand jury decided that they weren't going to indict Officer Darren Wilson. And what really struck me about that day was the fact that government officials waited until the cover of darkness to make their announcement. And I'm thinking this has to be intentional. First of all, there's been a long period of unrest, like 2 months of unrest. They know that people are enraged about what happened to Mike Brown and how it was a part of a pattern. I mean, because in between that time, we saw 12-year-old Tamir Rice be killed in Cleveland, Ohio. We saw Eric Garner be choked to death by police in New York. And so there was so much outrage at what was going on. So I'm thinking, why would the government set it up for what they know is going to be a decision not to indict this man at night? They know that they have far more firepower than any of the protesters, most of whom unarmed, nonviolent. They have the power of the law on their hands to arrest people. They have chemical weapons. They have all these things that can show the American people who's boss. So when the deck is stacked that far in your favor, why would you take it to the next level by using nighttime as a cover for whatever was getting ready to happen? And so some of my fears came true that evening as I was watching the news and watching social media. And one of the things that really struck me was the fact that there had been a safe house. I think it was called like Mocha Bee's. It was like a coffee shop in Ferguson. And the police decided to raid Mocha Bee's. They threw tear gas and all types of chemical weapons into that safe house. Now, as a mom, what I saw were children who had been tear gassed. 8, 9, 10-year-old children with tears mixed with chemical weapons such as tear gas coming down their faces. And I was mortified. And I got to the point where I said, well, maybe I should go to Ferguson. Like, I said that out loud, and there was a part of me like, no, you shouldn't. And then I remember asking my kids to pray. And I said, you know, I feel that God is calling me to Ferguson. I'm like, but I'm not sure. And I'm like, so can you guys pray for me? And maybe about 30 to 45 minutes later, my son, who was 9 years old at the time, said, Mom, God said that this is part of your journey. And when he said that to me, it really impacted me. And I booked the flight. And the next day, I traveled to Ferguson. And I went there as a legal observer through the National Lawyers Guild. And all I had was a phone number. I did not know where I was going, didn't know where I was going to sleep. I just showed up at the place where they were training legal observers. And I'm so thankful that I took the risk that I took by going to Ferguson and I had that experience. But it was during the week of Thanksgiving. And so my kids gave me the blessing to leave. But my first night in Ferguson, I remember, you know, seeing the protesters lined up. It was very dark. Seeing rows of police officers and then behind them rows of the National Guard. And this was in downtown Ferguson where a lot of the action was happening. And the police were standing there to guard the police station and the fire department, which were right next to each other, because they didn't want anyone to vandalize those buildings or to set them on fire. And so, you know, protesters are chanting, they're singing, just a typical, you know, situation. And then some of the protesters broke away and they went, you know, down the street and they flipped over a police car and set it on fire. Now, no one was in the police car, thankfully, but it sent, you know, all the emergency responders to that area. So then we started walking with the crowd as legal observers, started walking further down the street, and we were standing as part of a big crowd. Now, mind you, you know, we had on these lime green hats, so you could tell we were legal observers, but we were unwelcome, you know, in Ferguson by the police. They considered us no different from the protesters, and we were told in our training that we wouldn't be treated any differently from the protesters, that we could be tear gassed, we could be arrested, we could be shot with rubber bullets. It did not matter. Didn't matter that we were lawyers and law students. The police didn't care. And so we were warned about that, but I, for whatever reason, didn't think it would happen. So when we broke away and we were with the protesters in a different area, someone, unfortunately, took a bottle and they threw it at the back of a police SUV. Now, after that happened, this huge police officer got out of the back of the SUV with the mask on, and he just started spraying us like insects with tear gas. No warning, no nothing, no time to run. And I remember for about 15 minutes after being sprayed, I could not see. I had fluid coming from all parts of my face. I couldn't breathe, and I was disoriented for that period of time. And I remember I had to pick leaves up off the ground to wipe my face off because I could not see anything. There were cars whizzing by. It was just so scary. And I'm thinking, what was I thinking coming here during Thanksgiving week? I should be making dressing and macaroni and cheese and having a normal Thanksgiving, but here I am in Ferguson. And while I'm sitting here privileged, feeling sorry for myself, as the tear gas began to wear off, I looked around me and I saw some of the young people who had been chanting and protesting and on the front lines dust themselves right back off and got right back to the front lines like soldiers in an army. They did not let the impacts of the tear gas deter them or make them question why they came out there to protest in the first place. They realized that the temporary discomfort that they experienced as a result of the chemicals that were being sprayed far outweighed the importance of the bigger cause of fighting for an end to police violence, especially against unarmed individuals. They realized that their temporary discomfort was no match for thinking about the system of policing, thinking about mass incarceration and the impacts on the poorest and most vulnerable people. And I remember thinking to myself, well, if they can do it, then I can do it. And so for the rest of that week, I just watched, I paid attention to the protests. I wore a dual hat as a legal observer, but I also was mindful of the things that were happening, the strategies that were happening while I was in Ferguson. And as soon as I got back to Minneapolis, I was approached by young people saying that they were gonna start Black Lives Matter Minneapolis, would I help them? And I'm thinking, I'm a law professor. I have no idea what help I could give, but I showed up anyway at the first meeting. I was the only one wearing a suit, but I just said, hey, I'm here. And they talked about shutting down I-35. Now, before Ferguson, I would have been like, no, I am not helping to shut down a freeway. But in thinking about my experience there and the courage of those young people and connecting it to the courage of those who marched on the Selma, on the bridge in Selma, the Pettus Bridge in Selma, facing police violence, tear gas, all those things, thinking about those who were jailed, who were bitten by dogs, who were sprayed with powerful water hoses, thinking, you know what, this is a part of my responsibility. Now that I know, now that I've seen it for myself, now that I've connected my experience in academia to real-world protests and our movement and the history of my people, I have to get involved. And so I did. I was part of about 100 people who had joined in the fast food protests where fast food workers were striking for higher pay. And as their march was wrapping up, we marched right on to I-35. Now, thankfully, they knew what they were doing. They were very well organized. And they were able to shut down a large stretch of the highway. And during that time, we were marching, chanting, singing, protesting. And we had state troopers enter the highway, and they threatened to arrest us. And one of the most powerful things that I witnessed was a young person, probably in her early 20s, who was leading us during that march, hear the state troopers through their megaphone saying, if you do not exit the freeway now, you will be arrested. And she looked at the people, and she paused, and she thought about it, and she said, let's keep going. And that's what we did. We kept on going. And they wound up actually not arresting us because they figured it would take longer to arrest us than for us to naturally exit the freeway. And so once we exited the freeway, we didn't stop there. We marched all the way to City Hall. We held a rally in the rotunda of City Hall, and then we marched up to the offices of city council members. And we placed a demand on them because during that time, they were going through the city budget. And although we have some of the worst racial disparities in the country, in Minneapolis and the Twin Cities, they were going to remove a lot of equity funding out of the budget. And we're thinking, how could you do that at a time like this? And so we called them out, those who were courageous enough to come and see us. So we packed their office and we said, how could you do this? We want those cuts placed back in the budget. And we said, we're going to come back when you're having your budgetary meeting. We're going to make the demand. And that's exactly what we did. A week later, we showed up. We packed the chambers of the city hall where their meetings normally are. And person after person after person from different racial and ethnic backgrounds. Some people, English wasn't their first language. Some people, different religious backgrounds, different sexual orientations, lined up person after person after person and testified about the need to put that equity funding back in the budget. And after hours of hearing that testimony, they put almost all of that money back in the city budget. And so it helped me to understand and connect the dots between activism and protesting and going into the halls of power and demanding change. And I think that through those experiences that I've had, it makes me more serious than ever about the need to not only speak truth to power, but to, like Gandhi said, be the change that I want to see in the world. And to remind other people that you can be the change that you want to see in the world. If we don't like what's happening now in our society, then do something about it. We can't look around and wait for somebody to come to our rescue. We can't sit there and continue to lament number 45 all day long. He's getting way more of our attention than he deserves, when we should be mobilizing and organizing and thinking about how we're going to fight back against what's happening right now, but mobilizing to see what do we want to see 4 years from now and who do we want to see in office? And how are we going to use our collective power to get the job done? So I think that it's possible for that to happen. I think that it's going to take people who are very serious about the fight for racial justice, who are willing to get uncomfortable, who are willing to roll up their sleeves and do what is necessary, and who refuse to take no for an answer. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We're gonna have time for just a few questions and then we're gonna have some refreshments afterwards, but we have a runner in the back. But first of all, can we have another round of applause for Dr. Nekima Levy-Pounds? Thank you very much for those words, and thank you for reminding us of our history. As you all are thinking about your questions, I have a question that I wanted to ask of you, just kind of get things started, and then if you'll raise your hand, we have a runner in the back who has a microphone. If you'll wait for the microphone to come to you, we'll have a chance to maybe take 4 or 5 questions, and we'll have a chance for some refreshment. And are you going to be able to stay afterwards and continue to chat with us for a little bit? Fantastic. So as you were mentioning, we have a new administration and a very different set of priorities, a very frightening agenda to me personally, I think to many of us. But we have issues and challenges right here in the Twin Cities and in the state of Minnesota as well. Where do you want to see people putting their focus? Where are you going to be putting your focus and your energy?
Thank you. Great question. I want to see people operating at all levels. I don't think that there's just one fight that's going on right now. I think that people have to decide what fight they're most passionate about and willing to invest the time in and then actually do it, whether it's at the local, the state, or the national level. I think that there are enough of us to be able to delegate responsibility and then to send people out into each of those areas and also to use our influence to mobilize more people to get activated. I think we also need to recognize that, let's say that, you know, you choose the women's rights fight that's going on right now and that, you know, has come to the surface in recent weeks. If that's your fight, I think that that's perfectly fine. But I also think that it's important to recognize the intersections within your movement. And when we're talking about women, we're not just talking about middle-class white women. We're talking about women of color. We're talking about single moms. We're talking about working moms. We're talking about immigrant moms. So how are their voices being incorporated in that particular movement? And I think that in many of our movements, there's room, and I would say an obligation, to see where the intersecting issues are and to be willing to champion those issues as well. Be willing to show up when immigrants are marching for their rights, part of the women's movement, get out there and march with them. Don't just expect them to show up at your march and because you think that that's the most important, when really all of these issues are very important because they affect all of humanity. So how are we demonstrating that? When I spoke at the women's march that actually happened here at the Capitol, one of the things that I talked about during that particular march was helping us to realize that we have way more in common than we have that's different, you know, and making sure that we're raising up the voices of people who we don't normally hear from, and how that has to be a part of whatever strategy or agenda going forward. And making sure we empower people of color in leadership. You know, we're in a land that's 85% white. And there's nothing wrong with that in terms of, okay, this is our population, but it doesn't mean that all the seats of power have to be hoarded by the white majority. We have to make room for the voices of people of color because we tend to know what's best for our community. So that has to also be a part of the strategy. And I'm gonna invest my time here in my local community every now and then. I mean, I travel around the country, you know, speaking and connecting with people. But for me, this is where the fight is, because I feel that in Minnesota and the Twin Cities in particular, we have an opportunity to set the national agenda in terms of showing this is actually how you promote equity and how you live it out and how you demonstrate the beloved community. Given the levels of diversity here, there's no reason why we can't rise up in the face of that opposition coming from DC and say, we're gonna do things differently here. We're gonna shift the paradigm here, and we're going to come together and make sure that this city is livable for everybody and not just those in the upper echelon. Any other questions?
Yes. I'm an older student, but I wanted to comment on last evening the Black History, the Black Student Union presented a talk, Redefining Our Past, Determining Our Future. I'm hearing the professor here, Dr. Nekima Levy-Pounds, talking about moving forward in the face of opposition. One of the most important things, and the things I've heard you saying with your reference to history, and they did that last night at the lecture too, of knowing that the African-American Black history of the country and the younger students and younger generations. For us, it's superfluous in some ways. I don't mean in technicality there, but to know about Emmett Till and Rosa Parks, it's amazing how people don't know who these people are, what their temperament was, as you were describing Rosa Parks, the history of the death of MLK, which MLK Jr., a lot of people don't know what the background, the backdrop is. For example, and by the way, incidentally, that one speech where he mentioned guaranteed income for the very first time was made at a speech on this campus. They had lost that video, but they found it. So, but that was the first time I'd heard that he'd mentioned that. I, like you, agree that MLK's death was associated with his sphere of influence when he began to speak about the economic equality, and that's true. But that's how we know. That's how the students and young people are going to know, with us as the older ones passing down our history, you as students being educated, you have the education, you know you have to pass down, like the griots, what the African-American history is.
Thank you for that. Any other questions or comments? We have one right here.
So my question is about, I think you were speaking a little bit to this, kind of like, what does it mean to be an ally in this day and age? And you were talking a little bit about complacency and how we need to kind of shake ourselves out of that. So if you could talk a little bit more about what it means to be an ally.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So I think allies have, honestly, a lot to learn, especially if they're new to activism and demonstrations. It's not saying that people are not coming to the table with intelligence or passion. I think a lot of people have that, and a lot of allies have that. But there's a different paradigm when you're stepping into a space that is Black-led or led by other people of color. Because part of that paradigm is completely opposite of how an ally would typically function in the rest of society, where they never have to defer to people of color or see them from an equal perspective and listen to what they have to say. And so allies have to be able and willing to walk in humility, you know, when they're in those spaces, and sometimes just sit back and listen, as opposed to having the urge to dominate or feel that, well, I know, you know, how to do this better, or I'm better equipped, or I'm better educated, or those people are ignorant. I mean, sometimes those are the thoughts that people have. And it's not about people necessarily intentionally being racist. Sometimes it's implicit bias that's playing a role in people's thought patterns in terms of how they see people of color. So what I tell people is, you know, if you want to be a strong ally, one of the first things that you have to do is check your privilege, which means not one acknowledging that you have privilege. Now, I reference my own privilege as a Black woman in an academic position, you know, with, you know, degrees and all this stuff. I because I had grown up poor, I didn't realize how privileged my mindset had become until I went to Ferguson. I thought, because I was doing work in the community, you know, since shortly after I got here. That wasn't the issue. Once I went to Ferguson, I realized it was just a whole other ball game in terms of understanding grassroots activism and advocacy. So everyone has some form of privilege. But I would say that white people in Minnesota have a whole other level of privilege because they're in the majority, because every major institution is controlled by white people, because the wealth and the resources that flow all through our state are controlled by white people. The companies, the institutions of higher education, the mainstream newspapers, the television shows, all of it. And when that's your world, it's very hard to see people of color as equals, even if you want to. So checking your privilege, learning everything that you can learn about the movement that you're involved in, and learning some of these things about history that we talked about, and being willing to be vulnerable. You know, like I said, you have to have a spirit of humility to engage in this work, and it means acknowledging what you don't know and not being too ashamed to ask questions. You don't have to be the authority figure, because that's what, you know, that's the conditioning and that's the message. Just coming and saying, I don't understand this, pulling aside someone that you can trust and saying, I'm confused, or I don't really know what to do, or I'm scared I'm going to say something that people don't like, and just being honest about that and working through those things with someone, even if it makes you uncomfortable. I would say that the best growth happens through tension and discomfort. In Minnesota, people don't want tension, they don't want discomfort. But me being from South Central LA, I'm like, I'm sorry, I'm not Minnesota nice. I'm coming in, I'm gonna speak the truth. And yeah, you're gonna be uncomfortable because I'm just as uncomfortable speaking that truth, but I have to do it anyway. Any other questions?
Is there one final question for Dr. Levy-Pounds? We do hope you'll stay afterwards and there'll be time for informal conversation, and I think we may be calling it to a close here, but thank you again. Another round of applause, please, for Dr.
Thank you guys so much for being here tonight.
And we do have a small token of affection, a small token of appreciation for...
Bill, we got one more question.
Yes. Thank
Hello.
You so much.
You guys, we got one more question.
One last one. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, sorry for imposing, but thank you for that lovely speech, and I think it's really important that we have these conversations here at the university, because everything you've described is also happening here. Activists speak up, disrupt things, and then just get thrown under the bus by the administration. And there's some marvelous people doing intersectional organizing just like one floor above us in this building. But I've been wondering, the University of Minnesota has like 60,000 people in it, and it's its own small city in here in Minneapolis, St. Paul. And how have you encountered university administration, and the sort of, what role do you see them playing in these things? For example, the St. Paul campus of the university is right, Philando Castile was murdered on the border of it. Mm-hmm. And we're hopefully making some movement with the Falcon Heights City Council there. Mm-hmm. But where in your organizing with this local community do you see the role of university activism meshing in and working through, and how can we like work together that way?
Okay, so I haven't had as much interaction with the administration here. There are probably a variety of reasons why. I haven't necessarily reached out to the administration saying, hey, we need your help, because we've just been doing what we need to do. And they probably don't agree, you know, with some of our activism and protests and things like that. But I think that university students, and I would argue professors as well, who are professors of conscience, have a key role to play in standing up for justice. Now, everyone has a different role. Not everyone's going to be shutting down I-35 or shutting down the Mall of America or I-94 or occupying a police precinct. That may not be your calling. That may not be something that, you know, you feel led to do. And I think that that's okay. There's enough of us willing to do those things and take those risks, as we've demonstrated, so that we can get the job done. However, in an academic institution, you have people who have voices where they can articulate concerns in a well-organized fashion. You have people who can write powerful op-eds and blogs advocating for the type of world, the type of justice that they want to see. You have folks who can call up legislators, and saying that you're from the University of Minnesota might open the door to actually getting a seat at their table and having them listen to your voice as you advocate for change. It might mean helping to mobilize other students on campus to broaden the movement. And not everyone has to take on the same issue. It's figuring out, what am I most passionate about? What keeps me up at night? And who else agrees with me? And pulling those folks together and then thinking about, now what is it that we actually want to accomplish? Then being relentless until you get it done. We can't underestimate the role of young people, and especially folks in colleges and universities, when they get fed up with the status quo. That actually not only signals to the rest of society that it's time for change, but even the parents of those individuals who see their kids out there on the front lines will suddenly start to ask some questions. They'll be worried, but they might even get involved, which I've seen happen as well. So it's a key role for you guys to play. I would say don't let anyone silence you if you feel passionate about an issue. And don't just allow people to be thrown under the bus. Even if you're not the one disrupting a meeting or having a sit-in, what can you do to show support for those who are putting their bodies on the line? And silence does not equal support. So use your voices. So with that, thank you guys. Look forward to engaging some of you when we have refreshments.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you. We really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for spending this.
And we'll look forward to continuing the conversation out in the lobby. Please stay, have a bite to eat. We have refreshments and pretty tasty treats out there. So stick around and have a bite and continue to talk with Dr. Levy-Pounds. Thank you so much tonight. Thank you.